Introduction of Mediaeval Hymns and Sequences. Mediaeval Hymns and Sequences by John Mason Neale. Introduction. The hymnology of the Western Church may conveniently be divided into three principal eras. The first, which, borrowing a term from architecture, we may name the Romanesque period, extends to the conclusion of the pontificate of St. Gregory the Great, and is, as a general rule, distinguished by the absence of rhyme. Its principal writers are St. Hilary, St. Ambrose, Prudentius, Sedulius, St. Ennodius, and St. Gregory. The second, or medieval period, commences before the termination of the first, with Venantius Fortunatus, and extends till the revival of classicalism under Leo X, with a feeble struggle for existence till the time of Urban VIII. Its characteristic is the adoption in its earlier period of single, and in its later, of double rhymes. The larger part of its writers have left no name. Of those that have, the greatest are Fortunatus, Venerable Bede, St. Theodulph, St. Peter Damian, St. Bernard, Hildebert, St. Thomas Aquinas, and, if we take sequences into the account, St. Notker, Godescalchus, and last, but one of the most eminent, Adam of St. Victor. Thomas of Celano, if the Dies Irae be his, and Jacopone, if the author of the Stabat Mater, have each immortalized themselves by one poem. The third, or classical period, contains but one distinguished name, that of Santolius Victorinus. In the first of these periods, the church was unshackling herself from the fetters of metre. In the second, she was bringing out all the capabilities of rhyme. In the third, she submitted to the slavish bondage of a revived paganism. The following translations are entirely from the medieval period of hymnology, and are made on the principle of always accurately representing the metre of the original. I had intended to prefix a brief popular essay on Western hymnology, but the subject is far too vast to be treated, even popularly, in the bounds of an introduction to so very small a volume. The reader must bear in mind that the uncouthness of many of the passages in the following pages is only a faithful copy of that of the original, and must take into account the difficulty of grappling with the series of double rhymes which occur in the sequences of Adam of St. Victor and his contemporaries. Sackville College, Easter, 1851. Notice, several of the poems here translated will be found in Mr. Trench's Sacred Latin Poetry, a book which, whatever be the defects of its theology, can scarcely fail, by its learning and its good taste, to be useful. In one or two of the remarks on Adam of St. Victor, I am much indebted to Mr. Trench. But the larger part of my notes, notwithstanding their great occasional similarity to his, arising from the fact that both are taken from the same sources, were written before I was acquainted with his work, except by name. To him, however, I am entirely indebted for my knowledge of the poem of Bernard of Cluny. End of introduction.
Section 1 of Mediaeval Hymns and Sequences. Mediaeval Hymns and Sequences by John Mason Neale. Pange Lingua Gloriosi. Venantius Fortunatus, about 580. Venantius Fortunatus, whose life extended from 530 to 609, is the connecting link between the poetry of Sedulius and Prudentius and that of the Middle Ages. The friend of St. Gregory of Tours and St. Radegund, he long wandered over the south of France, the fashionable poet of his day. The latter half of his life, however, raised him to a higher post and to a holier character. He died Bishop of Poitiers. The following is in the very first class of Latin hymns, and is retained, with a few ill-judged retouchings, in the Roman breviary. Sing, my tongue, the glorious battle, with completed victory rife, and above the cross's trophy, tell the triumph of the strife, how the world's Redeemer conquered by surrendering of his life. Footnote. The recension of Urban VIII here entirely spoils the original. Pance lingua gloriosi prelium certaminis, by substituting the word lauream. It is not to the glory of the termination of our Lord's conflict with the devil that the poet would have us look, but to the glory of the struggle itself, as indeed he tells us at the conclusion of the verse. End of footnote. God his maker, sorely grieving that the firstborn Adam fell, when he ate the noxious apple, whose reward was death and hell, noted then this wood, the ruin of the ancient wood to quell. For the work of our salvation needs would have his order so, and the multiform deceivers art by art would overthrow, and from thence would bring the medicine whence the venom of the foe. Wherefore, when the sacred fullness of the appointed time was come, this world's maker left his father, left his bright and heavenly home, and proceeded, God incarnate, from the virgin's holy womb. Weeps the infant in the manger that in Bethlehem's stable stands, and his limbs the virgin mother doth compose in swaddling bands, meetly thus in linen folding of her God the feet and hands. 30 years among us dwelling, his appointed time fulfilled. Given for this he meets his passion, for that this he freely willed. On the cross the Lamb is lifted, on whose death our hope we build. He endured the shame and spitting, vinegar and nails and reed, as his blessed side is opened, water thence and blood proceed. Earth and sky and stars and ocean by that flood are cleansed indeed. Faithful cross, above all other, one and only noble tree, none in foliage, none in blossom, none in fruit compares with thee. Sweetest wood and sweetest iron, sweetest weight sustaining free. Bend thy boughs, O tree of glory, thy relaxing sinews bend. For a while the ancient rigor that thy birth bestowed suspend, and the king of heavenly beauty on thy bosom gently tend. Thou alone wast counted worthy this world's ransom to uphold, for a shipwrecked world preparing harbor like the ark of old, with the sacred blood anointed from the wounded lamb that rolled. Footnote. A verse is added by some which, though not original, seems ancient. When, O judge of this world coming, in thy glory all divine, thou shalt bid thy cross's trophy bright above the stars to shine, be the light and the salvation of the people that are thine. End of footnote. Laud and honor to the Father, laud and honor to the Son, laud and honor to the Spirit, ever three and ever one, consubstantial, co-eternal, while unending ages run. End of section 1.
Section number 2 of Mediaeval Hymns and Sequences, Vancouver, B.C. Mediaeval Hymns and Sequences by John Mason Neale. Vexilla regis prodiunt, venatius fortunatus, about 580. This world-famous hymn, one of the grandest in the treasury of the Latin Church, was composed by Fortunatus on occasion of the reception of certain relics by S. Gregory of Tours and S. Ragdon previously to the consecration of a church at Poitiers. It is therefore strictly and primarily a processional hymn, though very naturally afterwards adapted to Passiontide. The royal banners forward go, the cross shines forth with mystic glow, where he in flesh, our flesh who made, our sentence bore, our ransom paid. where deep for us the spear was dyed, life's torrent rushing from his side to wash us in the precious flood, where mingled water flowed and blood. Fulfilled is all that David told in true prophetic song of old. Amidst the nations, God, saith he, hath reigned and triumphed from the tree. Footnote. In the italic version, the 10th verse of the 96th Psalm is, tell it out among the heathen that the Lord reigneth from the tree. S. Justin Martyr accuses the Jews of corrupting the text, and Tertullian, in at least three places, quotes the other reading. End footnote. O tree of beauty, tree of light, O tree with royal purple dight, elect upon whose faithful breast those holy limbs should find their rest, on whose dear arms so wildly flung the weight of this world's ransom hung, the price of humankind to pay and spoil the spoiler of his prey. O cross, our one reliance hail, this holy passion tide avail, to give fresh merit to the saint and pardon to the penitent. From every spirit praises be to God the blessed Trinity, whom by the cross thou dost restore, preserve and govern evermore. Footnote. These verses were added when the hymn was appropriated to Passion Tide. The ending of Fortunatus is this: with fragrance dropping from each bough, sweeter than sweetest nectar thou, decked with fruit of peace and praise, and glorious with triumphal lays. Hail, altar! Hail, O victim thee! Decks now thy passion's victory, where life for sinners death endured, and life by death for man procured. The last two lines are substituted in the modern Roman breviary for the concluding half of the first verse. The poet had possibly the distich of Sedulius in his eye. Vita beta nisium miseris avertir venit, pertulit a miseris vita beta nisium. End footnote. End of section 2. Section number 3 of Medieval Hymns and Sequences, Vancouver, B.C. Medieval Hymns and Sequences by John Mason Neale. Apparebit repentia magna dies domini, 7th century. This rugged but grand judgment hymn is at least as early as the 7th century, because quoted by V. Betty. Footnote. There is another hymn also quoted by V. Betty of the same rhythm and style as this, probably of the same date, and perhaps by the same author. I should have added it here, but for its great length. It begins hymnum dicta turba fratrum hymnum cantus personet. End footnote. It manifestly contains the germ of the dies iri, to which, however, inferior in lyric fervor and effect, it scarcely yields in devotion and simple realization of its subject. In the original, it is acrostic. That great day of wrath and terror, that last day of woe and doom, like a thief that comes at midnight, on the sons of men shall come, when the pride and pomp of ages all shall utterly have passed, and they stand in anguish owning that the end is here at last, and the trumpets pealing clangor through the earth four quarters spread, waxing loud and ever louder, shall convoke the quick and dead, and the King of heavenly glory shall assume his throne on high, and the cohorts of his angels shall be near him in the sky. And the sun shall turn to sackcloth, and the moon be red as blood, and the stars shall fall from heaven as the dead leaves in a wood. Flame and fire and desolation at the judge's feet shall go. Earth and sea and all abysses shall his mighty sentence know. Then the elect upon the right hand of the Lord shall stand around, but like goats the evil doers shall upon the left be found. Come ye blessed, take the kingdom, shall be there the king's award, which for you before the world was, of my Father was prepared. I was naked, and ye clothed me, poor, and ye relieved me. Hence, take the riches of my glory for your endless recompense. Then the righteous shall make question, when have we beheld thee poor, Lord of glory? When relieved thee, lying needy at our door? Whom the blessed King shall answer, when ye showed your charity, giving bread and home and raiment, what ye did was done to me. In like manner to the left hand, that most righteous judge shall say, go ye cursed to Gehenna, and the fire that is for aye. For in prison ye came not to me, poor ye pitied not my lot. Naked ye have never clothed me, sick ye visited me not. They shall say, O Christ, when saw we that thou calledest for our aid? And in prison, or sick, or hungry, to relieve have we delayed. Whom again the judge shall answer, since ye never cast your eyes on the sick and poor and needy, it was me ye did despise. Backward, backward at the sentence, to Gehenna they shall fly, where the fire is never quenched, where the worm can never die, where are Satan and his angels in profoundest dungeon bound, where are cries and chains and gnashing, where are quenchless flames around, but the righteous upward soaring to the heavenly land shall go, midst the cohorts of the angels, where is joy forevermore. To Jerusalem exulting, they with shouts shall enter in, that true sight of peace and glory that sets free from grief and sin. Christ shall they behold forever, seated at the Father's hand, as in beatific vision his elect before him stand. Wherefore, man, while yet thou mayest from the dragon's malice fly, give thy bread to feed the hungry, if thou seekest to win the sky. Let thy loins be straitly girded, life be pure and heart be right, at the coming of the bridegroom, that thy lamp may glitter bright. End of section 3.
Section 4 of Mediaeval Hymns and Sequences. Mediaeval Hymns and Sequences by John Mason Neale. Sancte venite corpus Christi sumite. 7th century. Rugged and unpoetical as this hymn is, It has a certain pious simplicity about it which renders it well worthy of preservation. It is an early example of a metrical composition, sung during the communion of the people. The communio of the Latin, like the koinonikon of the Eastern Church, never now appears but as prose. The present hymn seems not later than the 7th century. Draw nigh and take the body of the Lord, and drink the holy blood for you outpoured. Saved by that body, hallowed by that blood, whereby refreshed we render thanks to God. Salvation's giver, Christ the only Son, by that his cross and blood the victory won. Offered was he for greatest and for least, himself the victim and himself the priest. Victims were offered by the law of old, that in a type celestial mysteries told. He, ransomer from death, in light from shade, giveth his holy grace his saints to aid. Approach ye then with faithful hearts sincere, and take the safeguard of salvation here. He that in this world rules his saints and shields, to all believers life eternal yields, with heavenly bread makes them that hunger whole.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.